Hello, I'm Stéphane Ducasse. I'm an INRIA fellow researcher. I usually work on program analysis for software evolution. And also I'm expert in language design. But today I want to invite you to discover the powerful tools that we develop or that we use for live development in Faro. So I want to thanks SCAM for the invitation for giving this keynote. I also want to thanks the industrial partner of the Faro Consortium because they pay our engineers and I thank them for that. So what I propose to you, this is a little journey in a live environment and the tools. So I will give a brief overview of what is Faro. Then I will present some advanced features that are useful to create crazy tools and then some tools that we have. And I want to finish by showing that Faro is research friendly because we interact often with other research groups and that we have a win-win situation with that. So first, what is Faro? So Faro is a pure object-oriented language inspired by Smalltalk plus a full IDE. It is powerful, elegant and fun to program and it is a living system that you have under your finger. So Faro works on most OSs and it is fully MIT from the virtual machine up to everything. So Faro with numbers. In fact, since 2008, we released 13 different releases. That consists of a language core with compilers and library, plus an IDE, plus tools, plus frameworks for about 700 packages. We have 27,000 tests that we run on 5 platforms each time we commit. Faro is around 9,000 classes and 130,000 methods for the core system. We have 15 to 18 core developers in Faro and 100 occasional contributors. This is an international project, by the way, and this is growing. We have many things on GitHub. So for us, Faro, this is not the end of the journey. This is just the vehicle that we use. We use it for doing research, but we also improve it every day. But Faro is not the result of our research. So why do we do that? In fact, we want to have a powerful engine so that we can invent or reinvent our own future, to quote Alan Kay. But we do it in a way that we want also to create an ecosystem where innovation and business can bloom around Faro. I will not have the time to really go into the detail of the success stories in Faro, but companies are doing really crazy stuff like managing telephone communication for fishermen in Iceland, to sell system in Japan or registration system for cars in Germany, banking in Argentina, or in France, for example, there is a group that is doing all the requirement engineering for the user interface for submarine and aircraft in Faro. So I said that Faro is elegant and I will show it to you. So in fact, the full syntax fit on a postcard. In fact, I'm lying. This is half of a postcard. On this half of a postcard, you have the full Faro syntax. There is nothing more than what is written on the screen. So the idea is that we have 20 abstract syntax tree node, so it means that we can do really simply some analysis. So at the end of the day, what is a Faro program? This is a world of object. We have object with messages and closures. The model of Faro is rather simple. Everything is dynamically typed. Everything is an object instance of a class. There is no exception. Even exceptions and class or compile methods are object. All the methods are public virtual in the C++ sense. All the attributes are protected in C++ sense also. There is single inheritance with traits. In fact, the traits that you find in Groovy or sometimes now in PHP or Perl are coming from our work. So at the end of the day, we don't have constructor. We don't have a static method because we have a class methods that are late bound. We have no operator, no modifier, no boxing and unboxing. We have only objects, message, and closures. So now Faro is really highly immersive. What does it mean? It means that Faro is not a black box. You can really inspect everything. And you can also modify it. So this means that you are not outside of the aquarium, but you are inside of the aquarium, interacting with your object. And I want to show you a video that a teacher did in Switzerland to explain to his student what was the field to program with Faro. So on the left, you have the program and the guy is editing the program. And each time it turns blue, it is compiling and you see the results. And when I saw the video, I said, oh, I want this video because this is exactly what we are doing, even if we are not doing 3D. So you see, so this means that often people come to Faro because they want this super fast feedback on what they are doing. And of course, we don't do 3D, or some of them don't do 3D. And what we do is that we do the same with web application, sockets, network sensor, live programming, because when we program in Faro, we modify a live object. And for example, in my team, people were hacking the coffee machine to be able to program the coffee machine from Faro. So now I want to show you a bit what is the infrastructure that we have below the scene. So the first one is that everything in Faro is written in itself. So this means even the virtual machine, which is a mixture between assembly, C and C++, most of it is generated from Faro and tested in Faro. And everything else that we have is written in Faro. So what are the, I selected some features. So we have first class instance variable. So this means that we can say to a class, give a semantic to the class. So we can turn to an instance variable. So this means that we can define daemon, relationship, and all kinds of things. We have fast resumable exception. So this means that we can catch exception and resume them or relaunch them as other exceptions and things like that. We have a runtime class and object migration. So what does it mean? It means that when we modify a class on the fly, which we do all the time when we add an instance variable, all the method, all the objects are automatically migrated for us and change shape behind the scene. We have a customizable compiler. We can serialize and share execution, full execution stack. So this means that if you have a bug, for example, you can save the stack on the disk and reopen it in another system. We have an optional system virtualization, a bit like a Docker. We can save the complete environment and reopen it on another OS. And Faro is fully bootstrapped, so we can have different kernels down to 200k. So some people use this kernel to do JavaScript, I don't know what system, where they can use Faro inside and things like that. Now we have a really advanced reflective layer. So basically we can annotate and transform at runtime any piece of IST. And the recompilation act as a JIT also. We have a full stack reification because the stack can be an object in Faro. We just have to ask. And for that, with that, we can build continuation for web servers, for example, or exceptions. We can enumerate all the instances of a class super easily. And all the code that we manipulate, it can be also causally connected. So this means that we can manipulate the code as object. And when we change those objects, it changes the code and the inverse too. We have also a feature that is really interesting for tool builders is that we have a atomic build object swapping. So what does it mean? It means that we can swap atomically all the pointer to an object to another one and the inverse at the same time. So this means that like that, we can change the world behind your feet without you knowing it. So we love tools. So tools are our friends. And I want to show you the first one that was not developed by us originally. We just rewrote it, but it was done by the original people of Squeak. Because Faro is a fork from Squeak. We have large library. You want to know, you know what you want, but you don't know how to express it usually. So for example, often, I don't know. I know that if I have 11 and 2, I want to get 5. So this is what I will say to the tool. I will say, please, I give you this object with this result. Find me the message. And here, the system will say, OK, this is a slash slash. And slash slash is defined in collection, duration, integer, large integer, number, point, and small integer. But the class, the methods of the class that return true are integer, numbers, and small integers. Okay, okay. And also, what the system is telling to me is that there is slash slash and co. So this means that I have these two methods that I can investigate. So now, if I want to do the same, but I want to say that it returns 5.5, the system will tell me, ah, okay, this is slash, and show me that this is defined in fraction or in numbers. We can also, for example, ask, okay, what are the messages that are sent to the character 0 and that return true? This is what I express like that. So what you see is that I can query the system by giving example and get back the message that are returning the right value. And how this is done? This is done a bit in a brute force, but not totally naive, because we have to filter, because in Faro you have methods that can really destroy the system if you invoke them randomly. So we have to filter them, and there is the system that manage that for us. And this is really nice because we can do a query and get the information. So about tools. In fact, the tools are shaping our mind, and Faro has this notion of modable tools. It was really thought with in conjunction with Tudor Girba from Fink, and this is a really interesting concept. So the idea is that you can adapt the tool to you and your process, and not the inverse. And you can build also fast your own tool. This is really one of the vision. So from that perspective, Faro has some really interesting moldable tools, and I will start to show you the first one. So we can customize the interaction with the object and the representation that this object is giving us. So just to give you an example, the team of Alexandre Bergel was working on a representation of the temporal change inside the database. And for that, they have this kind of 3D representation of the rows and columns in a database, and then the evolution of them. And this was a 3D representation. And what they did, they extended the inspector, which is just an object to see what is inside. This is a tool to see what is inside object. And they extended it with this pane, this live pane, where they could plug the 3D visualization of the matrix cube object and interact with it. So here you see that they click on a cube and then they can navigate their space because they get after an inspector on the object. Of course, I cannot run it on my machine now, so I will show you something a lot more boring, but this is really the view on a file. So I recorded a little session and I will show you. So what is a file? What is a file reference? A file reference, this is basically a path inside a file system. So here I ask the default, the working directory, and what I can do with the raw pane is that I can ask the path of this guy. Okay, and I ask his parent. You know, this is a file system, so what can we do with that? So just boring stuff. So now, what the tool let me show see is that, oh, it can show me, oh yes, this is also a file system. And here I can select a class, I can select a file, and then I can see, again, this is a file, this is a file reference, but the tool changed and said, oh, this is a text file, so maybe you want to see what is inside. Ah, yes, that's what I would like to see. And still, my object is a file reference. And I can do the same with a PNG. So you see, with a PNG, I can see, oh, yes, this is a PNG. Look, this is written inside the file. Or, oh, that's the PNG that is displayed. Okay, of course, I want to see that kind of guy. And again, we can do the same with archives. So here, this is okay. I can send information again to my file system, and the item in the archive. I can see that this is an archive because this is a PK zip. I don't know what, and I can navigate again the file inside the archive and have the same recursive behavior. So we can do it for UI for file system, and I want to show you that this is not magic. This is cool, but this is not magic. You can define your own. So this is the idea that most of the extensions that we have in Faro were made by Faro developers around the world, and they send us that, and we integrate it. So here, what we said, okay, you will display what? The result of the PNG writer on the file. And when do we do that? Only if it is a file, only when the file, the mind type is ready for a PNG. So then I was thinking, okay, files are boring, but we can do better. So I was thinking, what is really complex in Faro? Okay, what is complex are the classes and the compile methods. So I want to jump into that. So a point is an object. The class point is an object. So how do we see it? We see, when we inspect it, we see several fields, the superclass, the format, the layout, whatever, and the method dict. So let's go inside the method dict. So the method dictionary, basically, this is what the virtual machine is using to fetch the methods. And in fact, I don't want to know how the dictionary is implemented. In fact, I don't care. What I want to know, I want to navigate. So here I will see, okay, this is dictionary. So I have a key, and as a value, this is the name of the variable, the method. And as a value, this is the compile method object. So I can click on a compile method object, and then a compile method object, it's a super annoying object. This is just a list of numbers, and we have literals and things like that. So this is, you have to learn by heart that zero is push receiver zero and things like that. Or you can change the tool to give you such information. So for example, the tool, I can see the inside, I can see the source code of the methods. I can see a better representation of the bytecode. So for example, here I see that zero, in fact, this is push receiver zero. So this means that it push the X value of the receiver. So we can also navigate the abstract syntax tree. And what you see here is that when I select a node in my abstract syntax tree, I can see which portion of the source code it's referred to, or I can do also the same with the bytecode. So here, when I select push receiver one, which is basically push the second instance variable of the receiver, which is Y because I have X and Y, then I can see it. So what I just want to show here is that the tool, we can adapt it to what we want to see depending of the things that we are doing. And that's really interesting. Decided to adapt the tool to our domain. And people often extend the basic inspector because this is the primary user interface that they have. This is cheap and they do it fast. So now I want to show you something completely different, is that in Faro we love tests. We write tests and tests and tests and more tests. But we do it in a strange way. We do it what we call not in TDD, but extreme TDD. So what do? We write tests, the test fails, and then we code in the debugger. So I want to just to show you that. So here, in fact, Faro use SUnit, which is the ancestor of GUnit, and this is basically the equivalent of GUnit 3. So we write a test case, class, and then we will write a test method that starts with test. And here we said, okay, set and get. So we will put a value in a counter and then we will check that the value is the correct one when we retrieve it. So counter is slanted because the class is not known by the system. And then here we said, okay, that should be equals to 24. Superb. So now when we compile the method, the system said, oh, I don't know the class counter. And you said, yeah, okay, it proposed to me to develop it and that's okay. Now when I execute the test, the system barks and said, okay, I don't know what is this method. Of course, I didn't define it. And now I ask him, okay, can you create the method for me? He does it, change the stack on the fly so that now I'm still inside the debugger so that I can edit my methods. And now I define an instance variable. I said, oh yes, yes, of course. And then I can proceed. And here count, this is the same. But now the system is a bit clever. He said, oh, this is a getter with the same, this is a method with the same name as an instance variable. So it should be a getter. And he proposed me the implementation directly. It was just, and now my tests are green. So let's do another one. So if I want to add increments, for example, test increment, this is, I will define a temporary variable. I will put an instance, create an instance. You see a new, this is a message sent to a class. So I send a message new to the class, I get an instance. I will set a value, like count 12. I will call increment. Call increment, and then write my little assertion, self assert, blah. Okay, and I execute. Of course, increment does not exist, so the system tells me, oh, do you want to create? Yes, I want to create these methods. Okay. And then in increment, okay, this is count equal count plus one. And what I want to show you here, this is really the flow of programming. I just write my test, I execute, the system fails, and I go inside. And then by side effect, I create the code, I edit, and I compile the code in my class. And that's really super interesting because we do that for everything. And this is this moment, this special moment, we are in a close communication, interaction with our object. Within the debugger, we have the most precious context. And this is super important for us, and the flow is really nice because we don't have to switch and we don't have to guess. So, for the debugger, so we love the debugger. So we have what we call a hot update on the fly customizable debugger. So you saw it with a stack and things like that inside. We can do step at the level of the expression and not just as in Java as the line level. But what is more interesting is that, for example, this debugger is a debugger that has been developed by John Brandt, which is developing a compiler in Faro, where he can, for example, parse all kinds of languages, and here he is parsing Java code. What is really interesting is that the debugger that I show you is just the right pane below. The two below panes. And all the rest, this is the jump table of his framework. And this is super important because the bugs, they are often not in the code, they are in the table. So that's why having this debugger is really important for John, because it is a domain-specific debugger. So now for Faro 9, we are completely revisiting the debugger. And we will be able to have plugins for our debuggers, and we support something really super cool. This is object-centric. So this means that you can say, I just want to alt only when this specific object will change, or when this specific object will receive a message. And that's really super important for people doing UI and things like that. And we are introducing advanced scripting, where we can script the debugger based either on the abstract syntax tree or the call stacks, or mix the two. Now, what we also have in Faro, which is quite powerful, this is a live visualization scripting. This is ROSAL 3. This is developed by Alexandre Bergel from the University of Chile at Santiago and the company Object Profile. This is really gorgeous. And basically, it includes also a DSL for scripting. So here, I just use it just to create a little shape. So I said, okay, I want shapes that are rectangle, the size of the shape, that should be the number of variable of the class and the number of variable of methods. The node should be the subclass of the collection of Faro. So what we see on the right, this is the hierarchy of the class collection. And then I want to display it as a tree, and then I get that. And this visualization is completely interactive. And people use that for network latency or disease in Africa. Alex was showing that he had fun with the old basic developed by Bill Gates. In 1 hour, it was producing all kinds of visualization. People are using also ROSAL to display the execution of the generation of tests using IA techniques or analysis of Android application. What is really interesting for us is that often developers write their own tools. So here, this is also, I guess, the team of Alex Bergel that is doing a JavaScript analysis a tool for analysis for that. Now, this is a probabilistic data structure. I have no clue what is it, but this is a small company in Spain that is doing that. And what I like when I saw it is that the guy did not only define the data structure, but also provided the tools to understand the data structure. And that was like, yes, that was the catch. And also a company in Belgium is doing some HTTP traffic analysis, because they are using Faro for all the backend of their companies, and they do only HTTP things. In our team, for example, we started to work on ARM 64-bit JIT, and then the guy were fed up to have to read assembly on the fly. And then they created a little stepper so that they can step inside the 64-bit assembly. Now, I would like to share with you what I call a moment of grace, is that in the past, we were often working and we didn't like what we were doing. We said, yeah, we are missing these things, what can we do, and things like that. And then from time to time, we decided to do it. And it was the elegance behind that was really nice. I want to show you the first one. So in fact, often I want an alt that is only stopped when I call it from that method and not another one. So often I want to stop the code only when this is called from this method of my test, So how do I want to express that? In fact, I want just to write that like that. I want to say, please put a breakpoint or stop when you are called from this method. That's it. So this is basically a control flow. I want a control flow alt. So how do we implement that? Oh, that's easy. We just use stack trification. We walk it, and we alt if necessary. And this is the definition on the right. You know what we do in this context, verify the stack. If we are at the top of the stack, we stop. Else, what we do is that we check, oh, is the stack element the same as the one that is mentioned as the argument? Okay, in that case, I should stop. Else, I should just move up the stack. That's it. Now, something else is that we support rewriting of deprecated code at runtime. So the key aspect there, this is we ask ourselves, okay, how can we support our users to migrate from version one to the other one? Often we deprecate the API, but how can we help them to change their code? So basically we have rewriting deprecation. What is a rewriting deprecation? This is just a deprecation that says, oh, by the way, if I am executed, I want my caller to be rewritten like that. So here I said, oh, receiver, when you receive the message CR log with a statement, please rewrite it by calling CR trace with a statement. And then we ship that, and also companies are using that for their product. So basically, how does it work? It works that we run your test, your code and your test, that then use the new API. So this means that when you call the deprecation, the system will rewrite the call. So how does it work? At notification time, we walk the stack, we get the caller IST, and if it should be rewritten with the pattern matching engine that we have, then we rewrite it on the fly, and then we proceed. And we have something like 300 rules like that, where we can, like that, we can help people to migrate from one version to another one. This is not the complete ideal solution, but at least it works. And we will be really interested to have more solution, to have better solution. Sorry for the interruption. So now I want to finish by saying that Faro is research friendly. What does it mean? What do I mean by that? Is that first we have something like 17, 18 research group doing different stuff with Faro, so and we pay attention to them. So this means that as a general principle, we are researchers, not when we develop Faro, but we are researchers, and we are ready to help you validate your ideas with our system. And we are interested in tools, tests, refactoring, program transformation, visualization, merge, tool, DSL, recommending system, profiler, code optimizer, type inferencer. So basically, we can be your guinea pig. Of course, we should pay attention because we have real users, so it depends at which level, but we can do qualitative assessment of your results if you apply them on our system. In the past, for example, we supported the research developed at University of Bern. There was a setting, and the system was saying, okay, you can send data about what you are doing to this server. This is anonymously collected, and we have all the infrastructure for doing those kinds of data collection and saving. For example, last year, the team of Alexandre Bergel got a Best Paper Award at ICPC on monitoring how people were using live programming. And we played the experience for them. Oh, oui, the community. We have also a test framework that is plugin-based, so we can re-plug different kinds of analyses. So, for example, we have executable commands inside the system, so we can check those kinds of things. With that, we got a paper at ICSI because we realized that there are rotten green tests in Faro, but also in all kinds of systems. Sorry. We work also with Serge Demeyer at University of Antwerp on test amplification because we would really like to get more tests. We work also with University of Brussels. They are working on map reduced debugging, and this is interesting for us if our debugging infrastructure can be extended to support them. I know that people are working on code review, like Alberto Bacchelli and Alexandre Bergel with Object Profile. For example, Thales in France is developing advanced UI for flight submarines and things like that, where they mix 3D, 2D, and tactile and VR with Faro. So we are not really good in that, but we support them in the sense that they are interested in having advanced debugging tools, and we interact with them at this level. So I hope that I convince you that Faro is an energizing and creative environment. We have all kinds of mechanisms to invent new generation tools. I hope that I convince you that modable tools are really powerful. I try to share that. Now, of course, you need to experiment that with yourself. If you are interested, you are welcome. We can really play all kinds of different role in a collaboration. We can just play the role of engineers because at the end of the day, we have companies with 30 million lines of Faro code. And usually when we release something, this is not a prototype. This is really production ready. And we have to pay attention to that. But it does not mean that we do not drop ideas or that we do not consider advanced experience in the process. So to conclude, for me, Faro, this is really a simple system that is fun and really empowering. This is really my main message and we love it. So thanks for your attention.